Hello, I'm Christian, one of the two founders of Altus Insight, a big data consulting shop based in Berlin. And today I want to talk on how we used HBase to, for near real-time processing of time series data. So first, I want to give a short overview of the application, how the old architecture looked like, how the new architecture looks like. Then I want to talk about the problem, what happens if you write time series data into HBase, and what hotspots are. Then I want to stress out the importance of key design. Then I want to explain how we solved our problem by writing a new input format, the multi-segment table input format. And at the end, I just want to give a short summary with our insights and experience. So what kind of application we were working on? The application basically tracks user behavior. If you know Google Analytics, you pretty much know what it does. So in this case, each customer has lots of users. Those users are website visitors. And it can also happen that a user belongs to different customers. This is the case if a user goes to website A and then to website B, then this user ends up in both customers' databases. And for this kind of application, the data must be analyzed, sorted by time for each user. This is important because if one wants to find out what a customer journey is, then this is important. For example, first a user comes by Google to a website, then he puts an item into a basket, and then he proceeds with checkout and in the end generates a sale. So how does the old architecture look like? In the old architecture, each customer had its own separate MySQL database. This worked pretty well, but it had two limitations. First of all, it was not possible to run an analysis across different customers, because each customer had its own database. And another limitation is that the number of events that can be written to the database server is limited by design, because each database server was like a single node, and at some point you can buy a bigger server, but only up to a certain point. So how does the new architecture look like? And we decided to go with an Hadoop HBase solution for data storage along with the MapReduce framework for analysis. So this design has two advantages. First of all customer data is stored in the same giant HBase table. And another advantage is that the number of events that can be written to the system is now limited by the number of nodes that reside in the cluster, assuming the key design is well designed. So this gives a pretty good scalability. So what is HBase? I mean, you've just heard an excellent introduction from Nicholas about HBase. It's basically a layer on top of Hadoop, and it is a giant distributed sorted map. But it comes with the unfortunate property that hotspots can appear when one wants to write time series data into HBase, which is the case with timestamps. So what are hotspots? Because HBase works like a giant map, it means that each region server, or in more detail, each region is responsible for a continuous range of keys, and then those regions are hosted on the region servers. So this means if this is the incoming data, it means that all keys in the range from A to B end up on this region server. And as the time goes on, all data with keys in the range from C to D end up in another region, and so on. So this means no matter how many region servers you have in your cluster, all the data almost goes to the same region server. And this is bad because it causes hotspots. So that's why it is important to think about key design. So for our application, our application required that we must be able to get all the latest N entries for all users. This is required by the application. So this means for us that our key had to look like something like the reverse timestamp plus user ID. So while this key works for our application, it comes with the problem that hotspots can appear. So what is the solution? As Lars just pointed out, a common solution is to use something like a salt or a prefix. So we said, so what we can do is we just take 100 buckets, and then for each user ID, we compute a bucket ID. So we take the user ID, use the modulo operation by the bucket size, and we end up with a bucket ID between 0 and 99. So this is good because now we were able to prevent any hotspots. And this key design also ensures that all entries for the same user end up in the same bucket. This is good because if you later on want to run your MapReduce job, all the entries for the same user end up in the same mapper. So as you can see in this graphic, this is like the same graphic as I showed before, but now with the bucket ID in front of our key. So this means for this, for keys in the time range A to B, they now have like a bucket ID in front of them, and now those keys are nicely evenly distributed to all region servers. The same is true for the next time range. All entries go to different region servers. And if you know Ganglia, Ganglia is a cluster monitoring tool, and HBase comes with embedded metrics that send all the important metrics to Ganglia. And when we changed our key to this design, we were able to see that all the writes went to all those different region servers in our cluster. So while this is good for distributing the writes, for our application, it had a new problem because so right now, if you want to run a MapReduce analysis on an HBase table, it only allows for one scan object to serve as input for a MapReduce job. So what is a scan object? With a scan object, you can basically select a certain range of your table. And you can, with the current MapReduce API, you can only, it means that you can only process one range of keys in a MapReduce job. So then we started to think about what can we do. One easy solution would be, well, we can just start one MapReduce job for each bucket. But it doesn't really make a lot of sense because having 100 MapReduce jobs on a fairly small cluster just doesn't perform. So we measured it, and a lot of our jobs even didn't finish. So we thought, wouldn't it be idle if we can just, instead of putting just one scan object into the MapReduce API, wouldn't it be better if we can just pass in a whole list of scan objects? So now we started to look on the internet to get some ideas on what to do, and we ended up on Stack Overflow and found a post from Dave L. On Stack Overflow, another user had exactly the same problem as we did, and Dave L said, well, you just need to do this, this, and this, and you'll be fine. So, well, then that's what we did. And we started to implement the multi-segment table input format. This input format essentially takes a list of scan objects, and this list of scan objects can serve as the input for the HBase MapReduce API. So, and with this input format, we were able to process all of our buckets in a single MapReduce job, and this gave us a way better performance. So, what are the details of the multi-segment table input format? Essentially, we extended the table input format base. This table input format base has a method getSplit. This getSplit method takes a scan object and returns a list of input splits. And those input splits objects are like the input for the mappers. So and now, instead of just passing in one scan object, we iterated over our list of scan objects and passed, and for each scan object, we called the getSplit method from the base class. And at the end, we just collected all of our input splits, returned them, and everything else went on kind of automatically. We put up this input format on GitHub, so you can have a look if you like. So, summary. So at the end, we found out that for our use case, we were able to use HBase to process continuous time series data. So one of our big insights was that using buckets is a nice way to distribute the writes over all regions, and it also avoids hotspots. And then having all buckets being processed in a single MapReduce job is a big win, because as I just said, it doesn't make sense to start like 100 MapReduce job on a single on a small cluster. It's way more efficient to just have one MapReduce job and having all regions being processed in this single MapReduce job. Well, that's all I got.
All right, thank you, Christian. We have time for two or three questions. Other questions? All right. Let me get to you.
Hi, I have a question. Do you know what the ratio of read to writes in HBase is, in your case? How many reads report to how many writes in?
It's pretty much like 50-50. So the app servers write the data into HBase, and then we have a MapReduce job that kind of continuously takes the latest n entries, processes them, and writes them back to a different data store.
So you don't serve data from the same HBase table
no.
real time?
No,
okay.
No.
Okay, thank you.
More questions?
I have one question. I don't know if I really understand something. Why not to read everything from HBase in Hadoop using the table input format and there just using the map to route the data to the reducers and doing the computations in the reducers? What do you need to create your own input format?
Well, so we try to do like some kind of real-time analytics or near real-time. So we were only interested in process the entries from the latest, let's say, 60 seconds. And it doesn't make sense to read the whole table each time if you only want to process the last n entries.
And how long takes your cycles?
Like less than a minute.
Uh-huh. So you are able to launch one Hadoop job every single minute, and you just create that input format that just get the top 10 for each customer. That's what you are doing. Right?
Yes, okay. Exactly. And actually, it almost takes more time to start and stop the MapReduce framework than doing the actual processing of the entries.
Thank you.
All right, let's thank the speaker again.